Hey guys, Kenna here. So today we're going to try and go ahead and wrap up our properties of EM radiation, waves in general, by looking at polarization, lasers, and holograms. Now, these are some rabbit holes, and we could really spend days and days going over what we can and can't do compared to the movie technology you kind of see here before you. But let's talk about what we can do, and then we'll give you some additional resources if you're interested in learning a little bit more about where we're at with holograms in particular. All right. So let's take a look at our essential questions. All right. So number one, what is polarization of light? Okay. You may have heard the term polarization, and it should at least ring a bell for polar from back in your biology days, but let's take a look at what polarization is. Number two, what is a laser? Notice that I put it all in caps here. And how does it work? Okay. Number three, what are the major uses of lasers today and how do they work? Number four, how do fiber optics work? Okay, this property of fiber optics, now that we're moving more towards Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, things like this, we're not using it as often, but there are still fiber optic networks, and that gives us a unique challenge to go ahead and talk about what we've learned about in terms of reflection, refraction, and Snell's law. And then lastly, what is a mirage and how are they created? So let's go ahead and jump right in and start by taking a look at polarization. Now, the easiest way to probably think about polarization is to think about shaking a spring back and forth. Okay, waves move along the spring in its long direction. The oscillations of the transverse wave is perpendicular to the direction the wave travels. Remember transverse waves from last unit. If the spring is shaken up and down, that makes vertical polarization. But if the spring is shaken back and forth, left to right, that makes horizontal polarization. Now, the polarization is the direction of the oscillations of the wave perpendicular to the direction the wave moves. Only transverse waves can have polarization. So you're not going to see this with mechanical waves like sound. So I have a little video that's going to go ahead and show this to you, and then we'll talk a little bit about what that means in terms of how it plays out for why we have, say, polarized sunglasses. Okay, so let's go ahead and take a look at this video.
The polarization of light plays a critical role in much of our technology. And it plays a very important role in experiments in quantum mechanics, which challenge our assumptions about the nature of reality. In classical physics, light can be thought of as a wave of electric and magnetic fields. Suppose that we have two of these electromagnetic waves in the exact same region of space. At each point in space and time, their electric fields will add like vectors, and their magnetic fields will add like vectors. In this case, the two waves add together to form a new electromagnetic wave with a higher amplitude. Now let us consider a new scenario. We again have two electromagnetic waves in the same region of space, but this time they are not oriented in the same direction. As before, the electric field will add like vectors. And the magnetic fields will add like vectors. This time, The two waves add together to form a new electromagnetic wave with its orientation changed as shown. Now let us consider yet another scenario. This scenario is the same as the previous one. Except that in this case, one of the two original electromagnetic waves is ahead of the other one. As before, the electric fields will add like vectors. And the magnetic fields will add like vectors. This time, the new electromagnetic wave continuously rotates through space and time as shown.
Okay, so I think you get the idea. You start doing a little bit of vector addition, and you're able to go ahead and see the waves change in space, and especially if they're out of phase, you're going to end up seeing a unique wave pattern start to form. Now, why does this matter in terms of polarization? Because when we start thinking about vertically or horizontally polarized light, what we're doing is we're only allowing those waves that come through in a particular orientation to get through the material. So if it's vertically polarized, only those vertical waves are going to be able to pass through when you have a perpendicular motion of the particular wave. Okay, now if you have horizontally, you're going to have the same thing, but those waves are going to have their, you know, transverse crests and peaks going at 90 degrees to the vertically polarized light. All right, this might be a good time for you to pop out and go ahead and watch the demo on polarization as I go ahead and start showing you how light comes through two different polarized filters. So how do we use polarization? All right, so go ahead and watch that demo, then come back here and we'll talk about it. Okay, so hopefully you have an idea of how polarization works and what polarizing filters look like. Now, probably the easiest example for you to kind of use is polarized sunglasses. Light that reflects at low angles from horizontal surfaces is polarized mostly horizontally. Because of this, polarized sunglasses are developed to reduce the glare coming off these types of reflections. They let vertical and other types of light through, but they block the horizontal so you can get rid of a lot of glare off these types of surfaces. Another one that uses this technology is LCD computer screens. Images on LCD, which stands for liquid crystal diodes, are made using polarized light. So this is why you can't really see them very well from the side, because the light rays are only allowed to go through in one direction. Unpolarized light first comes from the light source and then passes through the polarizer. The resulting polarized light then passes through numerous pixels of liquid crystal that act like windows. So that's how polarization works. So we typically use it with respect to polarized sunglasses and blocking glare because of the way light bounces off materials and develops kind of a horizontal polarization. The next topic we want to go ahead and cover is lasers. So let's start out with a looking at the laser basics. Okay. So laser, and the reason I put it in all caps when we were first looking at it, is actually an acronym. Okay. It's an intense a device that generates an intense beam of coherent, we'll talk about that in a minute, monochromatic, again, we'll talk about that in a minute, light, or some form of electromagnetic radiation, by stimulated emission of photons from excited atoms or molecules. The term itself, laser, L, light, A, amplification, by S, stimulated, E, emission, of R, radiation. Okay. The first laser was actually built in 1960 by Theodore Meiman at Hughes Research Laboratories, based on the theoretical work by Charles Hard Townes and Arthur Leonard Scholau. Okay, so let's watch a quick little video giving you a brief history of the development of lasers.
I wanted to do physics, and when I first went to Bell Laboratories, I did some physics for about 9 months, and then the war was coming along. They said, oh, we've got to work on the war, and everybody's got to work on it. You must do engineering and do radar. Oh, dear, I didn't want to do engineering. I wanted to do physics, but I had to do it. So I started working on radar, and I learned a great deal from that. That was very important to me. After the war, I was allowed to get back to physics in Bell Labs, and I studied water vapor spectrum and other spectra of molecules. That was the beginning of a big career in molecular atomic spectroscopy. We were using electronic oscillators as a source of the radiation to shine on the molecules to get absorbed. And electronic oscillators wouldn't work shorter than maybe half a centimeter. And I wanted to get shorter and shorter waves, and I kept thinking about how to do it. I worked on this. I tried various things in the laboratory. They didn't work. Then I was, everybody knew I was very interested in this, and I was appointed chairman of a national committee to try to study how to get to shorter waves, how to get oscillators at shorter wavelengths. Nobody had any ideas. So we had our last meeting in Washington. Decided, well, we'll just write a report saying that, no, we can't find any ways of doing it. And I woke up early in the morning worrying about it, the day of our last meeting. And breakfast wasn't ready yet. It was bright and sunny. I went out and sat on the park bench in Franklin Park, a nice park bench. Sat there. Now, why hadn't I been able to come up with an idea of how to produce short waves? Electronic devices just couldn't produce short waves. They couldn't react fast enough to oscillate fast enough. And said, well, of course, molecules and atoms produce short waves, but thermodynamics says you can't get more than a certain amount of power from them, and that power isn't very much. And Einstein pointed that out. Einstein didn't foresee amplification, but he understood the mechanisms, the quantum mechanical mechanisms. Now, Tolman, back in the early 1920s, he wrote a long paper about quantum mechanical effects and so on. He said, well, of course, if there are more atoms up here than down there, then in principle they would amplify, but he says the amplification probably would be very small, and that was it. He had about one sentence on it, and that was all. But he did recognize that it could amplify in principle. Well, nobody paid any attention to it. He didn't either. Law of thermodynamics says that the amount of power you can get depends on how hot you can make it, and that's the power per unit frequency. I said, hey, wait a minute. Atoms and molecules don't have to obey thermodynamics. See, atoms and molecules, they can be in two states. That's an excited state and a lower state. And if a light wave comes along, the lower state absorbs it, so it knocks the atom up here. Light waves can come along and stimulate this one up, this level, and make it drop down and give up a light wave. But there are always more down here than up there. Thermodynamics says there's more down here than up there, so there's always net absorption. I said, hey, wait a minute. We can get atoms in states where they're more up here than down here. I pulled out an envelope from my pocket and wrote down the equation. Looks like it really would probably work. Oh, wow. But now I went back to the meeting then. We had our last meeting, and I felt, well, this is a kind of a funny idea, and I think I won't try to explain it and bring it up now. We'll just go ahead and write our report that we can't find any way. So we did. I went home, and I worked it out some more and wrote it down in a notebook just how to do it. I knew, hey, wait a minute, that looks very important. And I fixed it up so I could get a patent on it and so on. Now, I wanted to get the short waves down to the infrared, shorter than a millimeter, let's say. But I had some microwave equipment then, and I knew it would be easier to do it in the microwave region first, try it out there. And so that's why I did it in the microwave region first, and that was the maser. Actually, when I was building the maser, it worked on it for about 3 years before we made it work. And a lot of people came along and said, oh, well, yeah, that's an interesting idea. But nobody competed with us. Everybody saw it, and, oh, okay. Nobody competed with us at all until we built it, and then it became exciting, and then a lot of people went into the field. My maser patented the whole field of masers and lasers. The lasers patent was a refinement patent of the maser patent. Maser means microwave amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. You stimulate the molecules to give the radiation. And laser is light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. I sometimes say, well, maybe we ought to have erasers for infrared amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. Of course, lasers now cover infrared and optical and ultraviolet and so on. Science is fun. Finding new things is fun. I've just had a good time all my life, and I encourage you to think about things, explore things, and find new things. It's great fun, and it's very important to humans.
Okay. So that's a big name there in lasers, and we now use lasers for a whole bunch of things, but you kind of get a brief history there of the discovery of the laser, starting out the maser. Okay, with microwaves, and then eventually to the visible light, which is what we more commonly use today. Lasers are a special form of light. They're not just traditional light comes off your light bulb. Lasers light does not exist in nature. It's a human-created technology, and the first light from a laser contains exactly one color because we have to be very strict in terms of what wavelengths are included. It's not a bunch of different wavelengths like coming from most lights. Scientists say that laser light is what they call monochromatic. Mono meaning one, chromatic meaning color. So this is one color of light. And remember, a color references a particular wavelength. And so what we're doing is we're narrowing this down to a single wavelength. And then second, all of the wavelengths of that same wavelength are in phase, causing their crests, their high points, and the troughs, low points, to be completely lined up. This is what scientists call coherent. So lasers are monochromatic and coherent. It means they're at one wavelength and there's a whole bunch of these waves and they're all perfectly lined up and in phase, amplifying their crests and troughs. The third facet to a laser is what we call columnated. While ordinary light waves from typical sources like flashlights, light bulbs, suns, spread out in all directions, but lasers don't do this. Laser light travels all in the same direction, exactly parallel to one another. And this means that laser light beams are very narrow and be concentrated on just one tiny spot. Whether you've played with a little laser for your kitten, or whether you've gone ahead and used one to power your Blu-ray player, or CDs are kind of going out now, but you've seen lasers get used before. Because the laser light is monochromatic, coherent, and columnated, all of its energy then is focused to produce a small point of intense power. This focus power makes laser light really useful for cutting and welding. It also makes it possible to control laser light very precisely and it can do all sorts of useful things like what we just talked about. But two big uses that we're kind of looking at today to try and make them more functional are holograms, holography, used in lasers to create 3D images, and fiber optics, light energy transferred through long flexible fibers of glass plastic to transmit information. And as I mentioned at the beginning of this video, we've moved a little bit away from fiber optics in favor of things like microwaves, when we start talking about cell phones or Wi-Fi or Bluetooth. And so fiber optics still has its role and still is used, but not to the extent that it was for a while. Let's go ahead and start by taking a look at holography. Now, this is a photographic technique that records the light scattered from an object and then presents it in a way that makes the object appear three-dimensional. Large-scale holograms illuminated with lasers or displayed in dark rooms with carefully directed lighting are incredible. I mean, you can actually create amazing three-dimensional holograms right now. But there are two-dimensional surfaces that show about absolute precision three-dimensional images of real objects. The new ones don't even have to wear any special 3D glasses or anything like that for, like you used to have to go in for 3D movies, for example. So they're recreating these images, and you can walk around them, and they'll even shift and change, but it's a very flat object. There isn't rotation to it typically, and if there is, it's built in so that it's still a flat thing that you look at. Now, we're going to show you some holograms here on the next slide, and if you look at them from different angles, you'll see different perspectives, just like you were if you're looking at a real object. And some holograms even appear to move as you walk past them, but they're not, in most cases, the three-dimensional holograms that we see when we watch Star Wars or Star Trek or anything like that. Okay. And while they may even change colors or completely look like different things from different directions, the pop-up movies in Star Wars, Iron Man, so on and so forth, are not something that we can do quite yet. Those are kind of movie magic. So let's start by looking at some real holograms, and then we'll go ahead and start looking at some of those science fiction holograms and how close we're actually getting. So all of these here are real holograms. The simplest one is to probably look on your credit card or your driver's license, and you'll see some sort of hologram on there. The other holograms, there are even setups that you can do where you can download images that allow you to create a hologram with your cell phone. And then if you cut up a piece of plastic like an old CD case, you can create these little shapes, you know, kind of broken pyramids that will allow you to kind of float an image up to look like a hologram. The newer ones, like they've been using in medicine and things like this, are different. They're viewable really only to the person operating them, and the images change as they need to go ahead and try and interact with what it is that they're looking at. This is hopefully the future of holograms, where we can actually kind of interact and move them using our kind of sensory or touch technology to go ahead and produce these real dramatic, beautiful, colorful interactive holograms. We have VR now, and if you take a look at some of the VR technology, everything from the Hologlass to the Oculus Rift, we're getting good at some of this technology, but it's virtual, it's not really 3D holograms like you see in the movies. Now, I used to get asked this a lot, less now, but one of the things that always used to come up was how Tupac was resurrected at Coachella Festival in 2012, right after he died, to go ahead and show up and do a concert at Coachella. Now, how did they do that? And they're like, oh, it's this crazy hologram. Well, yes and no. It appeared kind of like a hologram, but in actuality, this is a technique called Pepper's Ghost. This was named after the British scientist John Pepper, who adapted stage tricks, right, from doing Shakespeare plays and things like that, that were used in the theater by projecting an image onto an angled piece of glass, which is then reflected back onto the stage, and it gives you kind of this ghostly illusion. Now, 300 years before Pepper, the Italian scientist Giambattista Della Porta was the first to conceptualize this illusion in his book, Magia Naturalis, or natural magic. He described what would ultimately take the form of Pepper's ghost technique, and he titled it How We May See in a Chamber Things That Are Not There. Okay. And they've toyed with this idea even in movies. I don't know if you guys remember, it's not a great movie, but it's an interesting movie called Simone, and it's S1M1. So I'll just let you watch a little piece of the trailer here so you can kind of get the idea. All right.
That you want. I want to see her. Unless you show me Simone live and in person, I show these photos to the authorities.
You want to see her? All right. You got a deal. You want to see her? You're gonna see her.
Good.
Mr. Taransky.
Ah, hello, gentlemen.
We're all ready, Mr. Taransky. This time tomorrow night, she'll be standing right here in front of 100,000 people. We could have sold this out 20 times.
Yeah, the sound check went great. The laser show is good to go. Gotta ask you, though. You ordered an awful lot of smoke.
Well, that's the way she wants it, you know.
After you told us about the death threat, security guards are under strict instructions never to take their eyes off the crowd.
Very good. Excellent. Here, Simone wanted you to have these.
Well, unreal.
And remember, no cameras, no binoculars.
Ladies and gentlemen, Victor Taransky Promotions is proud to present Simone, live on stage for the debut concert of the Splendid Isolation Tour.
Let's get you in the hair and makeup. It's easier to make 100,000 believe than just one.
And now, the one, the only, Simone.
I love you. LA, it's great to be here.
Before the
Okay, so as you can see, it's interesting. This music promoter creates a fake person, and he fools everybody with a hologram. So it's kind of an interesting concept. Now, I want to talk a little bit about what the future of holographic technology might include. We'll give you a quick overview, and then we'll talk a little bit about some of the things that are coming out and what that might look like. You know, this is a little old now, and the technology is moving fast all the time. And so you may be able to find newer things than these HoloLenses that we're going to take a look at here in a minute. But let's go ahead and get an overview of the future of holographic technology and then take a look at the HoloLens. All right.
3D displays have already taken you to alien worlds in the movies. Soon they'll take your doctor inside your body. Since we decided to spice up the cave walls back at Lascaux, we have been obsessed with creating ever more lifelike and realistic images, and that includes 3D, whether it's a Hollywood gimmick or the next generation computer display. Our visualization technology has reshaped the way humans and machines interact. Tech companies like Apple are buying up patents to create glasses-free 3D displays, so you can bet that 3D is still in our future. But is it going to be like the movies? Are we going to have freestanding, floating holograms 360 degrees around like in Star Wars? R2-D2 coming up and shooting out that image of Princess Leia from whatever it...
Help me, Jonathan. You're my only hope.
Okay, that's creepy. No one told me we were doing that. Can that go away now? Thanks. We don't have the technology to make those kind of holograms, and maybe we never will. A lot of that's due to the bad information we've had about holography. For example, do you remember when Tupac Shakur blew everyone's minds by showing up at Coachella 2012 in hologram form? Yeah, see, that wasn't a hologram. That was actually this really cool angled mirror illusion called Pepper's Ghost, which we've been using for more than a century to simulate hauntings. So what exactly is a hologram anyway? When you take a picture with a normal camera, you're really just recording a single splash of light across a two-dimensional surface, like film. But a holographic camera, well, that uses a laser beam splitter to split into two beams of light. You've got one that's just a clean reference signal, and another one that you run over a three-dimensional object, so you can measure all those nooks and crannies and create a light map of that object. So, could we ever get to that freestanding hologram? Well, one way we might try is by using a lot of different projectors to project light into a cloud of fog. Now, the fog would actually act as a three-dimensional movie screen, and particles within the fog would actually reflect the light back to us. Maybe we're even going to come up with technologies we can't even dream of right now to make holograms possible. But here's a paradox for you. When did 3D become a gimmick? I mean, our world is in three dimensions. It's 2D that's the gimmick. We build machines in 3D. We play with our pets in 3D. I think the ultimate human-computer interface is one where we just strip away all of that division so that our non-computerized reality and our computer experience are merged as one. I mean, imagine that you are a telesurgeon. You've got a hologram of the patient in front of you. The actual patient is 100 miles away. You want that to be as accurate and seamless as if you were actually in the room with a blade in your hand. Or imagine how much easier your world would be if we could actually build the holographic interfaces you've seen in movies like Iron Man, where you move the data around. It comes to you. You're no longer playing in this two-dimensional space. It's playing in your world. Holography might even restore sight to the blind. You might be able to use a combination of gene therapy and special glasses that actually beam holograms back to your eyes to restore your vision. And of course, holograms will play a big part in one of my favorite subjects of all time, space travel. We can already simulate the elements of space travel using something like the Cave 2, which is at the University of Illinois in Chicago. They've even taken footage from the Mars landings, and they can give you a full three-dimensional simulation of walking around on Mars. And in the far future, Mars colonists might get a little homesick, so then they just go ahead and jump into Cave 3. Visit Sweet Home Chicago.
Ain't it good to come home?
So the possibilities for what this could look like moving forward are vast, and we've already seen some of this just in the way you're able to interact with your cell phone. You can now open the camera up in your cell phone and place different names, labels, options, menus, things like this over the top of what you're seeing out in front of you. Okay? And if we start thinking about the VR headsets, we can do more and more of this. It's not just for gaming, but we could go ahead and work on building a motorcycle, doing plumbing underneath your sink, you name it. Put on the HoloLens and we can have people kind of guide you through doing physical tasks in real time. So the future, it has a lot of potential. And I think one little snapshot of this environment is the HoloLens developed by Microsoft. And so this is an older video. I'm sure there's probably a newer now. I just haven't had a chance to look for it. But we can go ahead and take a look at the Holo Studio and see what we can go ahead and do.
Look around. Technology is all around us. We use it in every aspect of our lives. It enables us to do amazing things. But what if we could go further? What if we could go beyond the screen? Where your digital world is blended with your real world. Now we can. This is the world with holograms. What will they enable us to do? New ways to visualize our work.
You know, I have an idea for the fuel tank.
New ways to share ideas with each other.
How are things going your end?
I just put the images in OneDrive.
Perfect.
More immersive ways to play. New ways to teach and learn.
So put the new trap in the place of the old one.
Now what?
And tighten here and here.
New ways to collaborate and explore the places we've never been.
Look at this formation. Let's take a closer look.
And new ways to create the things we imagine. When you change the way you see the world, you can change the world you see. This is Microsoft HoloLens.
Pretty cool, right? So this is, this is definitely something that we're working on. Even the images that you just saw there are not quite to the point where that's where we're at. So the real ones look a little bit more like what you're going to see here in this actual demo of the technology.
It's the company's augmented reality headset. We saw early versions of this last year, but now it's more than a prototype. This week it started shipping to developers and commercial customers who have paid $3,000 to experience the AR headset in all of its glory. But what's it really like to wear it? I'm Lauren Good, reporting for The Verge, and this over here on my right is my colleague Tom Warren. If you have followed The Verge's stories about Microsoft, you probably know who Tom is. This is the main event, the HoloLens itself. So it's definitely not unobtrusive, but considering its size, it's actually pretty lightweight. You put it on by fitting this interior band around your head, and then you use this twisty dial in the back to adjust the fit. It can either rest on your nose or just above it. Air tapping is how you select things when you're gazing at all of the virtual stuff in the world around you. There's also a hand gesture called the bloom that tells the computer to go back to the start menu. So yeah, this thing is an entire computer on your head. It runs on Windows 10, which means that in addition to HoloLens-specific apps, you can do just normal stuff too, like browse the web. You can see how the air tapping becomes more than just a select function in a game like Robo Raid, which Tom played for a while the other day while wearing HoloLens.
So you tap to place it on the wall, and then it's going to scan your environment. You walk around, and it will scan them so you can see it pulsating off the walls over there. And this makes the best use, I think, of the spatial sound that you can hear in the headset. So you can hear stuff when it's attacking you from behind. So here you go. And basically you air tap and you shoot at these little robots here.
You can also air tap your way through Holo Studio, which is, in all seriousness, a holographic app for making other holographic apps. But if you're not into making apps, you can do stuff like make a Skype call to the Verge office back in New York.
Say hi, Neli.
Hello.
Who's this? Hey, this is Tom Warren.
Hello,
he's
Tom.
He's currently talking to us on the HoloLens.
Oh, wow. So and are we seeing what he's seeing?
Yeah.
This is crazy.
So what you're really experiencing with HoloLens is mixed reality. Some stuff is real, some stuff is not. Unlike a big, all-encompassing VR headset like Oculus Rift, you can still see some of the things around you while you're browsing the web or playing games. Things like walls or chairs or this table. It also feels slightly less dangerous than a VR headset because you actually have spatial recognition and a sense of depth. So, you know, maybe you won't hurt yourself trying to lean on an imaginary desk. But the way it's built also means that it's way less immersive than Microsoft has promised it to be. It's like the difference between looking at a projection of stars on your wall versus sitting in the middle of a pitch black planetarium. The graphics you've been watching in this video are the video outputs we got from Microsoft, but when you're actually wearing it, the field of view is limited. And that probably won't change once Microsoft ships this to consumers. So we had some fun with this new version of HoloLens. It's clear that Microsoft envisions this initially as something that will be used mostly for enterprise applications and in education and gaming too. What it will mean for the consumer market is still really a big unknown, and Microsoft is hoping that app developers might help shape that. It's definitely improved from the HoloLens prototypes we've worn before, and the experience of using it is way cooler than what it physically looks like. But it is still a headset on your head. And as cool as it is, it's a relief to take it off and return to the real world after a while.
What should I read on The Verge today?
Okay, so today we're gonna finish up by taking a look at fiber optics. Fiber optics is the use of thin, flexible fibers of glass or other transparent solids to transmit light signals, chiefly for telecommunications or for internal examination of the body. Now, fiber optics are long, thin strands of very pure glass about the diameter of a human hair. They're arranged in bundles called optical cables and used to transmit light signals over very long distances. Now, let's say you want to shine a flashlight beam down a long, straight hallway. You just point the beam down the hallway and light travels in straight lines, so no problem. What if the hallway bends, though? Well, you could place a mirror at the bend to reflect the light of beam of light around the corner. But what if the hallway is winding multiple bends? You might line the walls with mirrors and angle the beam so that it bounces from one side to the other side all along the hallway. And this is exactly what happens when you use an optical fiber. The light in fiber optic cable travels through what's known as the core. Think of this like the hallway. By constantly bouncing from the cladding, think of this as the mirror-lined hallways, okay, a principle known as total internal reflection. Now, because the cladding does not absorb any of the light from the core, the light wave can travel huge distances simply by bouncing off the cladding of the core. Typically, there's some sort of reflective, highly reflective material that encircles the fiber optic cable to allow for this kind of bouncing effect due to total internal reflection. And if you remember Snell's law, this is a great example of how we can use Snell's law and that critical angle to go ahead and find total internal reflection. However, over distance, over time, some of the light signal degrades or breaks down within the fiber, mostly because of impurities in the glass. The extent that the signal degrades depends on the purity of the glass, the wavelength of the light transmitted, and typically the shorter the wavelength, the faster it degrades. For example, if we're looking at like 850 nanometers, you'll lose about 60 to 75% per kilometer. If you're dealing with 1300 nanometers, you lose about 50 to 60% per kilometer. 1550 nanometers is greater than 50%. Some premium optical fibers show much less signal degradation, less than 10% per kilometer at 1550 nanometers. So how does this work? Remember how the lasers amplify the signal? So essentially fiber optic signals can be pumped up or amplified by using lasers to increase their strength and their travel distance. All right, last thing for today is taking a look at mirages. Now, a mirage is an optical illusion caused by atmospheric conditions, especially the appearance of a sheet of water in the desert or a hot road caused by the refraction of light from the sky being heated by the air. So what does that look like? Essentially, you get total internal reflection because the hot air has a lower N value than the cold air up above it. And so you see this kind of mirage or bouncing effect when it's not there. So we'll go ahead and play this video and we'll let you head off for today. Thanks, guys.
Mirages appear when you drive along a road on a very hot day and the tarmac, the asphalt on the road, is very hot, so you wouldn't want to put your bare feet on it. And suddenly, on a flat road, if you're driving in the right direction, you can see the sky as if there were a puddle in the road, reflected in the road, so that the light from the sky comes down and seems to hit a puddle and be reflected up into your eye. This is called an inferior mirage because it's below the horizon, it's underneath the horizon, it's called inferior. I mean, it's blooming wonderful. It's not inferior in that sense, it's because it's below. And the explanation for these observations was given by Pierre de Fermat, the famous French mathematician. He was a brilliant mathematician, and he wrote to somebody and said, the reason light travels in these funny lines is it doesn't travel in a straight line as people would imagine. It goes along the path which takes the least time. So the question this raises is, under what circumstances could this possibly happen? Well, imagine that light travels at different speeds and different parts of space. It's just as though you were going to another place through a muddy field. And if you traveled in a straight line through this muddy field, it would slow you down because it's so boggy. Alternatively, you go on a footpath in a detour to come round from the other side. And that might be the quicker and more sensible route. Well, in the same way, light could find that in some medium, such as water or air, it prefers to go in a region where it can speed up because then it can get there quicker. A practical example, I'm going to talk about a car on a road traveling along on a very hot day such that the tarmac gets inordinately hot. You wouldn't want to tread on it. And the air next to the tarmac gets very hot and as a result it expands. Whereas the air further up is cooler. And as a result, it's slightly more dense. Now, light travels faster in this less dense air than in this cooler air. So imagine this is a bit of the sky. Actually, it's my filing cabinet. And the light is, and I'm going to exaggerate this because it's not on this scale. The light comes down from there, gets near this hot air, and then it rises up to my eyes. And this path takes advantage of the fact that the light is traveling faster near the ground than up in the air. And compared to any other path that it might come slightly higher up or further down, this is the path which is locally going to take the least time. So what I'm going to see as I look at my filing cabinet, I'm going to see the sky or above it. But if I look down here, this ray bends up, comes into my eye, and I see it as if there were a mirror on the floor, and this mirror is reflecting the sky into my eye. There's another kind of mirage. Not an inferior one, but a superior one. And now, in this case, you look at the horizon, and it's maybe the sea, and you can't see anything there. But the light now is bent the other way, because just above the sea's surface, it is very cold. It might be the polar ice caps or the region near there. And further up in the air is hot. So instead of bending this way, it now bends that way. Now, the Earth is spherical, so we can see things from beyond the actual horizon, and they rise up, come up into the atmosphere, and come down again. And as I look up at it, it seems to be floating in the sky. This is the superior image. It comes above the horizon. People called it, in Italy, the Fata Morgana, because it was seen in Italy in the Straits of Messina. And they thought these wonderful shapes that they were seeing were created by a witch, Morgan Le Fay, the half-sister of King Arthur, and she was producing these funny shapes in the sky that they couldn't explain. So Fermat came up with this idea, but it was rubbish by everybody. They couldn't believe that light, an inanimate object or concept, could actually have a brain so as to be able to work out which path would take the least time. That doesn't make any sense. The only problem with this criticism is that this idea works. It fits all known experiments. So although intellectually you might think this is stupid, every time you use it to make a calculation, it explains what you see. Here's an example on a practical level. I'm going to talk about the reflection of light off a mirror. So imagine this is a mirror, and I'm standing up. Oh, I'll make this in a human being over there. And the light goes from this person to that person, and it can go in any sort of path, and I'll work it out, the path which takes the least time. And you draw all these paths out, and the one that takes the least time is a symmetrical one, where the angle of incidence in here is equal to the angle of reflection. This is one of the well-known laws of Snell. Now then, of course, light will go along this path, but this path along here, going from one to the other, is the one that's going to take the least time compared to all the other paths locally that there are. And that's why we don't see a million reflections. We just see the one in the mirror down here, and we see the other one directly in front of us. So you are seeing the sky in the ground, and you're seeing the sky directly. So you only see these two images. So now you understand that the light can travel from one to the other in a direct path, but it can also go on this path. And what's happening when there's a mirage is the light will come from this figure and come down and go up as a parabola, like that. And other paths are possible around here, but they don't contribute, just as these other paths don't contribute, and only that one adds up to create an image that you can see. Here is an ordinary mirage. There is the road. There is the bit acting as a mirror. So you can see this blue car reflected in the road. Imagine the light not coming from the sky, but coming from this car. And the light coming towards us from this car is coming down and then turning up and coming up at an angle. So we actually are seeing a picture of that car turned upside down in the road, acting as if it were a mirror.
All right, guys, that's all I've got for you. Have a great day. Take care of yourself. Stay healthy, stay safe, and I'll talk to you soon. So long.